My name is Ólafur Arnalds, and we're here in my studio in Reykjavik. Today we're going to talk about my new track, Loom, that I did with Bonobo, and it's on my new album, Some Kind of Peace. And we're just gonna break down the track to its individual elements, talk about the structure of it and why it is what it is. We'll also look at how all these sounds inspired this update to our Spitfire Stratus software. And then at the end, we'll play around with it a bit and see if we can make something new with it. Loom is mostly built up from a synth patch, which I made on this Korg PS3100 here. I think we're just gonna start by hearing a little bit how it sounds and see if we can recreate it on the Korg. We'll patch in the Korg onto the mixer. Basically, I'm sending a pattern from my Stratus software through to the synth here. It comes through like this. I think it's a fairly simple sound. What's really nice about this synthesizer, it's fully polyphonic, meaning that every note on this keyboard has its own routing, so it has its own oscillator, own filter, own envelope generator. That's actually the tuning buttons here on the left. You can tune every single note on it. So you have to tune it kind of like a piano, which can be quite frustrating at times, but it makes for a very lively instrument. What I really like doing here is to add white noise from the modulation generator. Use that to affect the tuning of the synth. So you're actually affecting the tuning of the synth with white noise. You're modulating the tuning with white noise. It's kind of funny little artifacts. I think we're getting close. We'll add a second LFO for the cutoff. Just to get a little bit of a movement. Oh, we have to patch that in actually. There we go. And when you put the resonance of the filter on the synth up really high, it starts screaming. That's kind of what's creating this lively sound, is that the LFO or the filter is moving. And when it hits the same frequencies as the notes, those individual notes kind of come out way too loud, and that's creating those little melodic elements inside the patch. We can add a little bit of the noise coming through the filter, which is actually just something that happens by accident on this synth, I think. It's kind of cool. Add some space echoes. The melodies going into the synth are actually created with my original Stratus software, which we based the Spitfire Stratus product on. But that software was made to send generative textures to two self-playing pianos. But when I started working on this song, I actually tried for the first time to see what happens if you send it to a synth and you create the same generative textures, but just like modulate different elements of a synthesizer. So the whole song is kind of just built on that first idea of using Stratus for synthesizers. So we have this giant update to the Stratus plugin. That update was kind of influenced by this particular sound. So if I play some of them for you, you'll notice that they're actually super influenced by this particular track. You got this one, for example. And this one is pretty much based exactly on the sound that I just created for you on the Korg. It But you don't have to sound exactly like me. You can adjust this as you want to get different types of rhythms. And this whole thing works in a similar way to my Stratus. You have to select a rhythm for each note that you're playing on the keyboard. So you've got infinite options here to work with. Let's hear a couple of different sounds. These are still coming from the cork, but very different patches. That's a techno song right there. Okay, so let's take a look at the track a bit further. So we've created that cork synth sound now, which is the basis of most of the track. What happens next is that you start having the Stratus piano sounds, which is actually what I originally created Stratus for, playing on top of it. Very similar rhythm, so it kind of has a little counterpoint playfulness with the cork. Again, we recreated this in our Stratus plugin, so you can make quite similar textures. So I did this song with Bonobo. Basically, while I'm working on all these synth things and the Stratus piano thing, getting completely lost in that, he is sitting on the sofa with his laptop. It's a really fun way of working. We can both patch into the same set of speakers. We can sync our computers through like MIDI tempo syncing and just both jam with computers. So he came up with these vocal chops that he built out of some old recording sessions that he did with a singer. It's three layers of vocals, and then I'm running them through a very distorted Moog filter. You'll hear if I bypass it, they sound quite different. So it's got a lot of drive on it. We've got some reverb on it, some more distortion. The filter is just slowly opening up, and at the same time we're getting more and more distortion. We're getting more and more delays, more and more reverbs. We have this crazy little delay channels that are hanging out in the background. This is made with, I think, the first digital delay ever made. It's a Lexicon Primetime. We added a little bit of a percussion element as well. No kick and snare kind of thing. There's some loops. And then just some classic 808s. I just really want to emphasize on the simplicity of things, to not add too many things, so the characteristics of those humans who are playing here or these synths that we've created get lost. We have the cork and the piano together. And these two things are essentially the same sound. The piano and the cork are playing the same notes, so all the piano does is to expand on the sound of the cork. It's not really adding a new element to the song. We've got the percussion group, which is the 808 and the little percussion loops. And then the third element is basically just the vocal chops from Bonobo. And really, that's it. That's everything the song is built out of. We leave enough space for each element to be completely alive, and we leave enough space for each element to have intricate details built into it, and have the whole character of those details and that instrument shine through. The vocal chops, they're like 12 tracks or something for that simple sound. But it's all the same element. It's not 12 tracks of different sounds layering up on each other and kind of just hiding each other at the end. And one really important lesson that I've learned in producing is that if you're trying to build something, you're trying to make the song bigger. If you add too many elements to it, you're not making the song bigger. You're just hiding every element that you've put in there so far. Size, so to speak, like something that sounds big, what does that mean? It doesn't necessarily mean that it's loud. It means that it has a big characteristic. You know how we talk about how some people are large, they're larger than life? They're not big humans necessarily, they're just a big character. And I think we can speak about music in exactly the same way. That synthesizer line is a big character. And you can kind of expand this idea onto like a very simple string line, as we have here in the ending. So even though it's a tiny sound, you can't add anything on top of that. You would just ruin it. So it needs to stand there on its own. So the song builds and builds using these three groups of elements, basically, where everybody expects there to be a drop. We don't do a drop. We basically take everything out. We take the bass out. We suddenly make the vocals clean, no more distortion. You can finally hear kind of what they're saying. And we go into this lovely, cute ending. For me, this is kind of a transitional song from my last album into my new album. We open up with these kind of crazy electronics. We build and build. And then at the end, we've kind of, you know, into this new world of peace somehow. So the synth that we've had since the beginning of the song suddenly isn't there. And I think that's really what makes this drop impactful, is that we're removing things, not adding more and more things. And we finally hear some strings for the first time in the song, just at the very end. Let's check them out, actually. So these are real recorded strings, but I initially programmed them using Ólafur Arnalds' evolutions, which is single-stringed instruments playing evolutions. You can even just press random and it will help you come up with new sounds, new ideas. It will spark something unexpected for you. So when we go into actually recording this, which we always do, the sample libraries never actually end up on the record. They're just more there to inspire and to help me write. We like to take that idea even further, that each and every note of the performance becomes a song in itself. So we spend a lot of time on a short, simple part like this. We'll spend half a day easily. And it's really important for me to have that time with the players, not just to have them come in, you know, on the clock, have to be gone in 3 hours, so I have to churn out this album, you know. But I really like to sit with them, talk about this song, become kind of like a hive mind, and really start visualizing what is it that we're trying to say with this music. We'll spend time doing experiments, seeing if that delivers what we're trying to deliver. If it doesn't, we'll record the whole thing again. We'll listen, we'll talk about it, and really just take it slow when recording. And I just want to play you kind of how this ended up and compare that to the samples, because if you think about it, there's no actual difference. it's just single recorded notes in both cases, but you'll hear some difference here. So that's the recorded one. And let's compare that to the samples. I love these samples, don't get me wrong. I think they're so useful and they're so inspiring. But when you listen to the real thing with having spent time here with the players, really thinking about what we're doing, you can hear that the music is going somewhere, that it's heading from point A to point B with intention. They know where they're going and they play differently because they know that they're gonna end up in a different place at the end of the song. They know that the feeling is going to evolve, even if they repeat the same note again and again. That note doesn't mean the same thing the second or third time they play it than the first time they played it. A sample library doesn't know that. Samples are amazing and they're so useful. But there's a layer to music, I believe, that we don't hear. We just feel it. I recorded these strings in here, put close mics on every player with cardioid pencil mics. Then we have three pairs of main mics that I can kind of pick and choose in the mix, depending on the song, what each song needs. In this case, we had a pair of KM83s, we had a pair of AKG C12A, and we had a pair of Cole's mic, really close to the strings, kind of serving as main mics. And they were set up in a bloomline stereo technique where you kind of cross the Omni mics over each other, and you get a really wonderful stereo image out of that. To make it thicker, we add a little Botox EMT plate reverb 240, a later version of the 140. A lot of people don't think it's an improvement, but for me, for what I do, it's a lot better because it's darker and warmer. I double that with a digital EMT reverb as well, EMT 246. We also add some tape delays to kind of get it all together at the end. So the strings here at the end, it's actually the first time strings are appearing on the album. It is the kind of opening to the rest of the album. It opens up that world for us. So I kind of just wanted to do a little experiment with some of these new Stratus synth updates and see if we can maybe make an alternative ending here. It didn't have to be strings, could have been a bunch of other things, because there's this sound in the new update that I really, really quite enjoy. That's really nice, actually. There's also this patch in here that is absolute favorite. I just really like how this one is alive. It's, you can play one chord and it just evolves forever somehow. Let's see what else we have here. Here would be to create a big ambient part. It doesn't work, actually. Okay, let's take a look at our chamber evolutions waves. Thank you. Let's try that. That works. We just have to do a little modulation on the dynamics. Okay, this is getting somewhere. I think we just need to add some basses to it. Duplicate, contact, waves, bass. Always name your tracks. I have to say this is fairly random, what I'm doing. I think it could be nice. I think what we want to do is to make it slightly longer. Make it kind of cute, not so heavy. All right, I got it now. I know where we're going. Let's open up this old synth patch from my composer toolkit. There's a patch in your toolkits called Soft Entrance. There's a trick to this one. If you take the voices and... So I'm playing chords with only four notes. So if we change our max voices, which is default in contact to like 400, take them down to four, take the attack down. So you hear the whole sample, you'll see that it actually has an attack on it. And now if you play the next chord, it will actually cancel out the previous one. If you do six voices, you're actually emulating the Juno 60, which this sample was created with. And if you would play the sound on a Juno 60, it would keep canceling out your old voices. Which is actually just kind of a cool effect. You don't necessarily want to layer all these voices together. So if we do this. So the trick here is to play the bass notes slightly before the higher notes. So you go boom, boom, boom. So then when you do the next chord, you will cancel out the bass notes, but the higher notes actually keep playing. Then you can get these kind of ambient high notes above a nice bass line. Let's try this with the track. Put the Moog filter on it, automate the cutoff, and let it open up slowly. I really want that sound that we just did to become the main thing of this extended ending. So I'm working quite a lot on it, just to add a delay. I want it to become really huge. Slap some Botox on it too. Some of these chamber evolutions here. This is my absolute favorite patch from that. Again, look, because we were talking about performance in samples before. If you listen to this performance, I can hold one note for you. it's still developing. I think what's missing from this ending now is kind of like a flurry of things on top of all this synth soup that we've created. There's a big bass now, there's some wave strings coming in at the end, and I think we want to kind of lead us into the wave strings with adding some string textures. What I would like to do is to fade these out even earlier. You can just kind of do it roughly like that and have them replaced by a different kind of thing coming. Kind of switch the tremolo things out for a more simple string at the end. We can make this work. So we'll just make a little wall of sound there at the end to find the right sounds for it. Okay, so I think we've got something interesting going on here. It's a new ending to the song. We've got a couple of layers of the new Stratus Swarm patches, which are just ambient machines. We've got a little buildup of that, and then a old toolkit synth comes in as a big build, and then we end with some chamber evolution strings here. Just for a really quick mix on this, so we can listen to it nicely, I'm gonna group the chamber evolutions together just so I can kind of modulate the volume of it and EQs together on an aux, because all of these are just doing a texture. I placed some tiny EQs on them just to take the harshness out. And we'll put one group master EQ as well, because there is a little bit extra. When you put a few things together, there are like places where they meet in the frequency spectrum. So you get kind of different needs for EQing when you play them together than when you play them individually. So I always like to EQ them as a group as well as individually. Let's add a nice reverb onto this. Lexicon. Okay, large hall. System noise off. This should be your default setting. Okay. We've got the chamber waves, add a little bit high frequency to them, take a little bit off the mids, send the reverb there as well. We want a little bit more highs on this. Okay, that's the strings. Let's take a look at the synth a little bit. Starts with this. We've already EQ'd this a bit. This lower octave is kind of taking from the other one, so I'm just going to put it more in the background with some reverb on it. It's more of a filler. We have this really nice thing here that I haven't really used so far. We recorded it earlier on, but it's a bit too much, but I'm wondering if I take the bass out of it, we can probably use it. Listen to this. Too much, actually. Let's try one more thing. Okay. All right, I think that's pretty much as far as I'm gonna take this today. We have now Loom with a new extended ending. I think it's quite interesting to see an ending using only the Spitfire products here. As we can see, it's mostly the new Stratus plugin with the, all these ambient synth additions, but I've added in a little bit of good old chamber evos and that one synth patch from the toolkit. So I think we should just listen to Loom featuring Bonobo with this new extended ending that we've just created. More information on all the libraries on the Spitfire website, obviously. My new album, Some Kind of Peace, is out now. I hope this has been informative for you. It definitely is for me. Analyzing my own work in this way kind of often gives me a good perspective on things, and I hope it did for you too. So thanks so much for watching, and see you again soon. Thank you.